first annual Veterans Recognition event in Wayne, New Jersey. My name is Maria Balarin, Director of Let Us Do Good Wayne, an organization committed to creating positive opportunities, inspiring community members to do good, and to encourage individuals to achieve their fullest potential. Veterans, this day is for you. We are really excited about the opportunity to say thank you for your service to this great nation. We have a long agenda. However, first I need to recognize the people and organizations that made this special day possible. The event committee, our chair, Nick Rocca, director of Passaic County Parks. Nick had the power to make things happen. Arlene Potenzone, the coordinator for the Dey Mansion, a true gem. This location would not be successful without her. Tom Miller, Passaic County Officer of Veterans Affairs, and the other individuals that helped, Maggie, Jennifer, and Teresa. Thank you, committee members. Our platinum sponsors, BAE System, Prudential, and Next Wave Graphics. Our gold sponsors, American Legion, Apollo Flag, and Intent Party Rentals, and all the other contributing sponsors listed on the event program. Special thanks to Robert Vaccaro, American Legion Post 174. Bob has been a hands-on sponsor who has worked closely with me every step of the way. Bob, thanks to you and your son, Chris. Thank you to our generous sponsors. We ask you that you support them as they have supported us. It takes many resources to put on an event for the community, so we value the overwhelming support from the veterans, volunteers, community, and business leaders. To help kick things off, I'd like to introduce my 16-year-old son, Austin Balarin, my inspiration, the inspiration for Let Us Do Good Wayne, and this event today.
Thanks, Mom. Good morning to everyone, including Wayne Mayor Chris Fregato.
Hey, Chris.
State County Realtor Terry Duffy and Congressman Bill Pascrell. We will start by the posting of the colors by the American Legion. Colors posted. Will everyone please stand?
Part-time bar.
Thank you.
States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the ocean, white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home.
Morning. It's my privilege to be here with you this morning. Daniel Webster said, God grants liberty only to those that are willing to defend it. And we honor all of you who have defended our liberty for these many years. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your presence here today, Lord, as we honor our veterans. God, we think of those who defended this nation at its very inception against tyranny of a monarchy, and to those who defended even today against the tyranny of terrorism. God, we honor each one in each battle, in each war that was fought. And God, we just pray your blessing will be upon this land and these veterans. In Jesus' name.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Dey Mansion.
Good morning, brother.
We're all glad you're here. This morning, as I was driving up, came up Ratchet Road, turned onto Alps Road, came down French Hill, I looked around at the surroundings, and I noticed a few things. A lot of garage sales today. A lot of joggers out there. Certainly, I'm not one of them, you can tell. People walking in the street. People driving on their way to stores. And our residents of Wayne Township in the United States can do that only for one reason. Only because we have the freedom, the freedoms that we typically take for granted and forget. And on one day a year, Veterans Day, we seem to remember that all of our veterans, for the men and women out there that have defended this country year after year after year, and without those veterans, we wouldn't have those freedoms to go to all those garage sales today, and to go shopping, and to walk around the lake, to jog, and to assemble in this very tent here at Dey Mansion. We forget. We have a younger generation, I can say that now, I'm 52, that needs to be reminded. And many of us will be attending ceremonies throughout the week at our middle and elementary schools, reminding our new generation of what our veterans have sacrificed. So today I want to thank each and every one of you. It's a very proud day here in Wayne. The first time I ever came to Dey Mansion was in the third grade. We were on a field trip. And no, I did not know George Washington, as many people have asked before. But this is truly a remarkable place we have here. And Maria and Austin and your committee, you should be congratulated for putting this together today. It's only one small piece of the thank you that we need to say to our veterans. And now I have a proclamation to read from the governor. Whereas all Americans owe a tremendous debt of gratitude and appreciation to the brave men and women who have served our country, currently serving in the armed force in the United States, to defend our freedoms and preserve our every way of our life. And whereas the United States has recognized November 11th as Veterans Day since 1954, when it replaced the holiday then known as Armistice Day, and whereas the state of New Jersey is home to more than 443,000 veterans, and whereas New Jersey's courageous veterans in the Army, Navy, Marine Corps, Air Force, and Coast Guard have made significant contributions to every year in military conflict in the history of our nation, and whereas it is of utmost importance for the residents of the Garden State to join together with all Americans in expressing their gratitude for the patriotic service of our veterans who have risked their lives to defend our Constitution and the sacred principles of liberty and freedom it represents. And whereas it is equally important to honor and thank the American service members abroad We're currently engaged in global war against terrorism around the world to ensure the security of our lives and our freedoms. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Chris Christie, Governor of the State of New Jersey, hereby proclaim November 11, 2011, as the official observance of Veterans Day. Thank you, and may God bless you all.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the privilege of being my being here to make some brief remarks on the history of this important site. In July, October, November of 1780, 231 years ago, General George Washington, the Commander-in-Chief of the Continental Army, arranged, accepted the hospitable welcome of his comrade-in-arms, Colonel Plutus Dye, of the Bergen County Militia, and made the Dye Mansion, then called Bloomsbury Manor, his military field headquarters. And here, with green fields stretching out into the Preakness Hills, Washington, Alexander Hamilton, the Marquis de Lafayette, and others who were to distinguish themselves in the founding of our nation, plotted strategies that ultimately resulted in freedom from the British Crown. We have abundant documentary evidence of what occurred here, in this stately home of well-crafted brick and stone. The 610 communications that number 1,275 pages, they detail military actions of all sorts, many highly significant and some mundane. They record the joy upon Washington hearing of the arrival of the French allies, and they tell of a shaken and grieved Washington, who told the President of the Continental Congress, from this spot on October 18, 1780, upon learning of Major Benedict Arnold's treachery and an attempt to turn over West Point to the enemy, quote, "Arnold's conduct is so villainously perfidious that there are no terms that can describe the baseness of his heart." Played out here in what is now a scenic park is a history, national in scope, that can arouse deep wounds and sacred memories. In a way, though, memories are insufficient when one thinks of how lives have been disrupted and lives have been lost. They are not, in that context, a remote abstraction. They happen because they have been those who were called to their country, and their countrymen could live in peace and retain that precious heritage we call liberty. The Passaic County freeholders are engaged in a restoration effort that, when completed in 2013, will guarantee that our historic Dye Mansion will be able to continue its educational mission of telling the story of a major consoling call, that the men and women of the Revolutionary War and the men and women of today, who likewise serve their nation and are here today because they sacrificed for an indestructible cause, for a country we love, because it is a free country.
Proud to be here with you. It's a great day for us. We know what it's like to be out there and not know what's going to happen, not only tomorrow, but the next hour, the next minute. So I want to thank you all and for being here today. Representative Pascrell, great seeing you here today, sir. Mayor, thank you very much. It's, I too share your dislike of jogging, as you can see. We contributed to the local economy at the local Dunkin' Donuts this morning, which was very good. Director of the Freeholders, Terry Duffy, great seeing you. You know, you all going to continue to improve the Dey Mansion and what's there. That is absolutely marvelous there. We had a great tour the other day, and I'm not one for history, but I could stay there and just listen for days on end. So this is really an absolute joy, so thank you. Fellow veterans and comrades who served preserving the peace, to our wives, mothers, children, sisters, brothers, daughters, sons, cousins, nieces, nephews, friends. and those of us who have served our nation during times of war, I bid you each a good morning, Wayne, at Passaic County. It's great to be here. It's a great day. And what a wonderful welcome, standing outside, chatting with some of the fellow pets as they came on here. Really, really just makes it great. It's great here also because our neighbor in Radcliffe, Kentucky, which is a small military town right outside of Fort Knox, Joe Battistoni comes from Lincoln Park. His wife Maria Giordano Battistoni comes from Passaic. So it's great to be here and finally see what their hometown is. And you should be very happy that they're in Kentucky. Really, they're great folks, and they remind me of Maria very well because they're really into the community actions, and there's none of this, we can't do it. Is it right? Is it a good thing to do? Does the community deserve it? Well, then let's get moving and let's not say no. So very, very proud to be here with you. I thank the folks that performed so well, the posting of the colors, the singing, the pledge from our young man in uniform over here. What a great job. Thank you very much. I thank the historian here for giving us a little bit about the history. History was never my subject in high school. It's not my subject now, but I have an interest now. Maybe because so much of the history I've lived through. So it's there. Now, how did I get here? And today I'm going to tell you how I got here, who is celebrating and recognizing, and a little about the Vietnam War, and a word to the employers about veterans. I met Austin and Maria down in Radcliffe, Kentucky, a mutual friend of ours who was a national chairperson for the Tunnel to Towers run. Roger Stradley called me and said, this gal that's running Tunnel to Towers in Wayne, New Jersey is going to be here. Our son is 16 years old. He's doing this project for the Library of Congress, and he wants to do all histories of veterans. We can come over and do that. So I meet them up there at the office of Bedrock, a small defense company. And Austin does the interview. While we're there, we start talking, and we find out that we have some more connections. Maria spent some time growing up in Queens, New York, as did my lovely wife Snux over there. She's from Queens. Found out last night through the American Legion, so is Dorothy from Queens. So we got all of this connection. So we had a very nice time doing this all history. We finished in about 45 minutes or an hour, so that's pretty good. I felt pretty happy about that. About 2 days later, I get this call. He says, John, I got this great idea. We're going to do this veterans recognition on a countywide basis in Passaic County, and I want to give your book away. I said, what? He said, I want to give your book away to the veterans that show up. And I said, now, have you read my book yet? You know, I mean, I'm not an author. I published the book, but I'm not an author. Okay? And she said, oh, yeah. Austin and I both read it on it way back, and we really enjoyed it, and we think that it's going to be good. And she said, by the way, could you come down and do the book signing? I said, okay, I agreed to it. And didn't hear much about it at all until about 2 weeks ago. Maria sent me an email, and she sent me a draft of the program that's on the paper. She said, what do you think? And I said, well, this is pretty good. Maybe you could make this change and kind of sort of be nice. Please don't call me a hero. She said, okay, fine. The next day, I get another copy of it. And she made the corrections, it really looked great. And I happened to just look inside, because I've been looking at the artwork on the front. And as I go down what the agenda and the itinerary is, I come across keynote speaker, and I see my name there. Now I'm getting a little old, tomorrow I'm going to be older. But I don't remember signing up for being a keynote speaker. But here I am, that's how you got me. Sorry, folks, it was her idea. Now, public speaking isn't really something that I like to do, but, you know, 20 years of career in the Army, you get a lot of opportunities to stand up and to address people. And whenever I get ready to do that, I hearken back to the advice my grandfather, my Irish immigrant grandfather, John T. Rogan Sr., told me. He said, Johnny boy, if you're ever called on to speak, you want to do three things. Listen up, okay? Because you're going to be doing this someday. Three things. One, stand up tall so you can be seen. Can you see me out there? Speak up loud so you can be heard. Can you hear me out there? And sit down quick to be appreciated. So I aim on doing that, okay? I aim on doing that, but we'll see how we do that. Now, I have two grandchildren, and I have two grandchildren that go to a Catholic school in Louisville. And our daughter works there as a teacher's aide. And she enlists me to do certain things, particularly around Veterans Day. And last year, she invited me up to talk to her little third grade class on Veterans Day. So I got my helmet, I put on my cap hat, and I was ready to walk into the class into the third grade. And when I walked in the door, there was all three classes of the third grade there. So it wasn't 30-1, it was like 90-1. And I felt, you know, I sort of wish I had some backup, some of these guys in uniform, to sort of help me. But I looked in the front of the room, and I said, okay, let me ask you all a question. You're pretty smart, you go to St. Patrick's School. What's a vet? Hands went up all over the place. Well, there's this little girl over here, and he was just waving and waving and waving. And I said, yes, tell us all what a vet is. She says, a vet is somebody you bring your pet to when they're sick. And you know, she's right. And I told her, congratulations. But a vet is something else as well. And I started to talk about what a veteran was. As I was preparing to talk today, I said, what was the first time I heard what a vet was? What's the first memory? My first memory is in Brooklyn growing up as a little kid on Veterans Day with my mother and my grandmother getting on a bus and going down to Grand Army Plaza where they had the Veterans Day parade. And I was told these men on here, many of them, my uncles were in parade and who was in the Navy and in the Army and the Air Corps. Were parading on there. And he said, these are the folks who fought the World War and won. Well, I looked at him like probably some of the young folks there looking at this guy and go, they're the guys that won the war? What the heck was the enemy like? You know, I mean, we were, you know, fat and all of this other stuff there. They could hardly walk down the street. Well, I'll tell you, I wasn't always like this, okay? When I flew helicopters in Vietnam, I looked like these young Marines in there, you know, pretty slick, pretty proud on that. But we kind of sort of get a little old and we go out. But I remember what a veteran was. But as I grew older, I learned the definition of a veteran. It is one who served his country in one of the uniformed services. I learned to believe that some believe that a veteran is only somebody who goes to war to defend the country. Folks, that ain't true. When you stand up there, and you raise your right hand, and you take that oath to defend your country against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that's an act of heroism. That's when you are signing up and prepared to give your life for your country and your nation. That's when you become a hero. Everything after that is doing the job. So whether you served in, World War I guys here, I'm sure, or we had World War II, and I'm sure Korea, and Vietnam, and the desert, and we have Afghanistan and Iraq, and we have those other minor things that happen that we're called on alert, and it's the Berlin, we got Dominican Republic, we got Cuba, all of those times. All of those folks who were enlisted and who served during that Cold War period where we kept the enemy on their side of the wall and their side of the fence. They're veterans. They were prepared. They took the same oath as anyone else. And for those veterans, for all of you veterans, gentlemen and ladies, I salute you. Thank you. And let... So they took that oath with no qualifications, no nuances, no, well, you know, if I'm around tonight, I'm not doing anything on Saturday, I'll fight and do my best. Hell no. This was, I'm going to go do it. And you can talk about, you know, I joined the service because I wanted to learn a trade. Well, you know, you do your trade probably 20% of the time, and 100% of the time you do your soldier stuff. And your soldier stuff is ready to defend right down to the last bullet and the bayonet. And that's what it's all about. And those of you that have been there, that have taken that oath, you understand what it is. And those of you that have been in combat, you know the love of a brother, you know what it's all about, you've seen the eye of the tiger, and you know what's happening. And you know what this country is worth, and why we defended it, and why our brothers, some of them, aren't here. And we thank them for that. Greatly amiss if I didn't recognize our Gold Star mothers and our Gold Star wives, as well as our Blue Star families that are there, that are the families of the folks that are serving today. You know, they served too. They didn't volunteer for it. They came along, but they sacrificed. We have to thank them, and we have to support them. We have folks in the community today who have family overseas that need help. Let's reach out, all of our organizations, on an individual basis, as a church, as the American Legion, the VFW, the Catholic War Veterans, the DAV, on and on. Let's reach out, let's find them, let's make sure they know that it's not just one day a year that we respect the veteran, but we care about them 365 days a year, 24/7. That's what we need to do, folks. Now, I'm honored and humbled to be here. Let's see, I wanted to talk about Vietnam. Now, in Vietnam, you're going to go to school, and how many have told you that America lost the war? Yeah, you heard it, you saw it on TV, America lost the war. Yeah, exactly right. They're the words that were going through my mind. He said, it's a cow in a pasture that got points. It is. I'm sorry. But it is. It's not true. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to get on your computer. No. I want you to get a 10-year-old kid or your grandson or granddaughter to get on a computer and Google. No, tell them Google. They'll know what it is, okay? They know what it means. Google Vietnam War myths, and then read some of the pages there and find out what happened in Vietnam. The American Army never lost a battle on a field. Never did. 10 of 68, way, I was there.
Amen.
We didn't lose that battle. That was the worst battle and the worst defeat for the NVA ever. Read the general's book. Now, unfortunately, the mainstream media didn't understand how to keep score. Okay? They were out on the city streets listening to a bunch of punks running around with long hair. They didn't understand. We know how to keep score. We know where it is. We fought that war to the Paris Peace Accords, to the peace table. And there, on the 29th of September, 1973, our last troops departed Vietnam. 29 March, 1973, we left under the terms of the Paris Peace Accords. Saigon fell 30 April 1975, 2 years later. 2 years later. Why did they fall? Congress, well, due respect, Congress wouldn't support them anymore. Congress withdrew the funding. However, the enemy to the north, they were well funded and well supplied, by Russia and China. They came through and they took over the South Vietnam. Those pictures you see in April of 75 of folks being airlifted out and the mass exodus out of Vietnam, it wasn't American troops that were there. There were Vietnamese civilians and military that were coming out. What happened to Vietnam now? Where is it? What's going on there? You ever wonder about that? Snooks and I went there about 4 years ago, 2004. We were back to Vietnam. I didn't leave anything there. Trust me. But I went back there with a young infantry guy, Barry McAlpine, who was one of my blues, flying in the back of the helicopter with me. I put him into some hell of a places. You know, it's interesting as an aside. You talk to some of these fellas from Vietnam, and they'll tell you, you're a helicopter pilot. I love the sound of the blade, the wop, wop, wop. Because they came in and they took us out. Or they brought us food, they brought us ammo. And they said, you are my buddy because you brought me out. And that wop, wop, wop reminds me of that. And I say, how soon you forget that wop, wop, wop also put you in there. But I thank them for forgetting about that part and remembering the good part of us coming to Vietnam. But in any case, we went back to Vietnam in 2004, and we went to all of the great places. We went to Saigon. They call it Ho Chi Minh City now, but even the locals there call it Saigon. We went over to Vung Tau. We went to Pleiku. We went to Con Tum. We visited the Catholic orphanage up there. Left some money on there to take care of some of the orphans that were there. We went to Da Nang, we went to China Beach, we went to Hoi An, we came back in, we went to Nha Trang. Amazing. When the people find out that you're an American, they look at you with love. I was in the shop, Ann and I were in a little shop in Saigon, about three blocks away from the Majestic Hotel in downtown, right by the Saigon River. And I was looking at this painting on the wall. And it had a religious theme to it, a little cross. And I'm just lost there, trying to get over jet lag, and I'm looking at that. And all of a sudden, there's a man to my shoulder. He's a shopkeeper. And he goes, I am a Christian too. Very important to tell me that. Then another shop found out we're Americans. Shopkeeper comes up in a very low voice and says, we love America. Thank you. Folks, we made our mark over there. The point of the story is that we've made our mark at the people in Vietnam, as I'm sure the American GI has done in every conflict. The American GI, with his optimism, good humor, kindness, sense of fairness, humanity, high morals, and unequaled heroism in the face of danger, are known and respected throughout the world. Now, I don't know how much contact you have with the pictures coming back from Afghanistan or Iraq of little children standing behind soldiers and Marines in full battle rattle, and they're standing behind them for protection. Does your heart good. So that's what we're there. But I digress. What's a veteran? What's a veteran to the employer? These employers that we have here, I find out, know what a veteran is. They know that a veteran understands that 0800 in the morning is 0800, and 0801 is late. There's no 10-ish in the service. It's 1000 hours, or you're late. So they've got that. They know their part and they perform their duties to the best of their ability. They know how to follow directions, whether someone's there or not. And that's what we call discipline. They know how to take charge when action can't wait. And they will act to accomplish the mission, placing their own needs secondary and third. Employers need to know that these young men with one and two tours have exercised more leadership and more responsibility than most of their military employees that are there. Employers, hiring a vet isn't just a patriotic thing to do. It's the smartest personal hiring business decision you can make. And these folks at Prudential, and these folks at BAE, they understand that and they actively recruit. But if your personal folks aren't screening for veterans to hire veterans, you need to set them straight right away. And folks, let me tell you about the National Guard and Reserves in our communities. They deserve a very special thanks and commitment from our business community. And welcome them back to the business world. They earned it, they deserve it, and your organization will be better for it. And the spouses and children that are left behind, they need help while they're gone. They need help as they're transitioning coming back. Go out and help them. Now, today's a super day to be here with you. It's a great honor and pleasure to be here. I hope you enjoy reading my book that's going to be given to you later on. I ask you that as you read it, if it strikes a memory of yours, write your memory down on a piece of paper and chuck it into the book. And as you read, put it in. Now, I might have made some mistakes, okay? If there's a mistake, write it down. There's a correction. Take that and put that into the book. And when you finish the book, then my book and your book become our book. And your family will know your story. As Veterans Day approaches this week, I wish my Vietnam-era brothers a hearty welcome home. Our comrades from the other conflicts and the Cold War, I salute you. To those now serving, I offer my deepest thanks and prayers for your safety, happiness, and success. Please welcome each other as we go about today, and enjoy enjoy ourselves. Okay, this is a great country to be at. Think of what we have. So many of our brothers don't have that opportunity to do. To the young cadets here, I'm impressed with their decisions and wish you God's greatest blessings as you take up the challenge. Representative Pascrell, Mayor, comrades, our freeholder, friends, I want to thank you and may God bless you and may God bless America. Thank you very much.
Let's give him a great round of applause. You sure you're only a sophomore in high school? I think he's a sophomore in college. He's trying to. Maria, thank you so much for all that you do, not only today, but all throughout the year. And a big thank you to everybody. Reverend Clergy, Mayor Pagano, thank you. Wayne always responds in a very different way, hospitable way, to our veterans and their families. And I want to mention that later on. I'm Freeholder Director Duffy. Historian Smite. Last Saturday, at this very moment, I was at West Point in a blizzard. I had taken a busload of guys, most of them veterans, by the way, half of them anyway, up to West Point to see a football game. And we would not be deterred in any manner, shape, or form. Of course, the other half were crazy, too, so, we wanted, as it snowed harder and harder as we got to West Point, it's only an hour and 15, 20 minutes, we were more enthusiastic to get there. Of course, they called the parade off, because the cadets don't march, whether that was pretty hazardous, let me tell you. Well, one of our stops, Major Arnold, no relation to Benedict Arnold, Todd Arnold, 32-year-old major, two tours in Iraq. He's at a couple places I was at when I've been in Iraq. He took us to the chapel, and I said, yes, you're right, Major, some of these guys do need a lot of prayers. But he took us to the chapel to show us the plaques that are displayed there of generals who have really, really served their country. And as we stood at the chapel, he said, you know, there's a plaque in this chapel for Benedict Arnold. And we were rather surprised, since all of us knew about what he represented, a traitor to his country. And so when he finished talking, I said, I want to know where the heck this plaque is. So it's upstairs behind the organ. And when you go look at it, Benedict Arnold's name has been scratched out. So we have many heroes and we have many villains. But this is the greatest country in the world. and it's only the greatest country in the world because of the guys and many of the gals in this room and our present Marine Corps and our present Army. It's funny that you mention the fact that Washington brought Hamilton here to the mansion. Because on this coming Monday, just 2 days away, Secretary Salazar, representing the President of the United States, will be in Patterson to fill out the final lap of us making the Great Falls a national park for America. A national park. The history that was made at the falls, the history that was made at the falls, and the history that is made here on the very spot where we stand and sit, is history that you can't make up. It is the very fiber, and the very bone marrow of this nation. I want to conclude with this thing. We have work to do, Marine. Many of our veterans that have no shelter are homeless. 20% of them. And we have attempted in the last couple of years to recognize that fact, but we've done it in a very minuscule way. The people who defend this nation should be our major priority all the time, not just on Veterans Day or Memorial Day. And there are veterans who gave on the battlefield all they had, left it out on the battlefield, some mentally, some physically. You know, the signature injury of both Iraq and Afghanistan was traumatic brain injury. We finally put some money into the budget to recognize that fact. So not only did we not give our guys and gals the right resources when they went in, but when they come out, we didn't prepare. We didn't allow for what would have happened. And that is a shame. And we need every day to understand that. So shelter. The homelessness is unacceptable, we need to say, to America. Unacceptable. As tough as things are now, think about it. A guy or gal goes to defend us, he goes back and he's got no house. He's got no apartment. Think about that. Food and water. But shelter first. Food and water. And health. The tremendous amount of energy that they had, many times diminished by what happened out in the battlefield. Some seen, some unseen. Contusions, but sometimes a traumatic brain injury, most of the time, there's no blood. And many of them don't even want to admit that they're, and John Flanagan could tell us about that history. They won't admit that they've been injured. Something's different, but they don't want to take it because they don't want to be seen as a wussy. And yet what happens is they do more harm to themselves. So their health is critical. We need to respond in kind to the sacrifice that they made. Not just talk about it. We're good at patting people on the back. We pat our veterans on the back. We pat our cops on the back. We pat our firefighters on the back, our EMTs on the back. And we give them no play. See, we're good at patting people on the back. Forget of putting our grandchildren up on a fire truck when the police come. I mean, the fact of the matter, we laid off 12,000 police officers throughout the United States of America is an absolute crime. And for people in Washington, you send us down there. If we don't want to respond to that and find all kinds of reasons, where are we going to find the money? Christ, we find money for everything else. If we can't protect ourselves, if this is a part of the first responders in defending America, and what? We're just talking out of both sides of our mouths. And finally, the families. The families of these veterans. It's our job to respond to the signature injury of traumatic brain injury, post-traumatic stress disorder. Families and the presence of families have a tremendous positive impact on male and female soldiers, helps them more to recover. We lost a lot of our soldiers 5-6 years ago because we weren't up to the job. And now They are being saved. Their lives are being saved. We're finding ways because there's been more research on the brain in the last 5 years than the past 500 years. We are living in good times and we don't even know it. We're saving people's lives. It's our job. And finally, a job. I know the president had a great idea. Give companies incentives to hire veterans. We can't even get that passed. We are good talkers. Oh, we give great speeches. Great speech, Pascrell. But it's action. And it's all of us. It's all of us together. Don't listen to this baloney. We can't afford it. We sent these people out to defend us and we can't afford to help them. We can't afford. All of a sudden we can't find 10 cents. Oh, really? So, Marie, you've done your part. Austin, you've done your part. We have to make sure we do our part. These are beautiful guys and gals that defended this country and continue to do so. We've had a great year in our services. We took down the person who perpetrated 9/11. We took his second guy down, 9/11. And we got rid of this clown in North Africa, and there's other ones that are going to be leaving as well. God bless America, and thank you for being here today.
How do I follow that speech? I thought I was behind the mayor, and I think I could maybe handle that one. On behalf of the St. County Freeholders, I am Freehold Director Terry Duffy. I'm standing, and I make pretty good speeches if somebody writes it for me. So I talk from the heart. I want to thank you on behalf of all the Freeholders for all your service and for the people who aren't here that we can't say thank you. So thank you for the St. County Freeholders. Now that being said, I'm standing between you, the sunshine, the beer, and the coffee, and the donuts. So let's go outside and enjoy the day. Thank you for coming.
I'm just talking about Vietnam. I was stationed in Florida in 66.
He says it's going to give it away.
Around the country, there was Nike Hercules missiles and Hawk missiles to protect the United States. So a lot of different towns, especially around the coastlines, California, San Francisco, Miami, I was in Miami, Key Largo, heard of Key Largo down the Florida Keys. Yeah, Key Largo was a big thing because Castro started up and had the Cuban Missile Crisis. That's part of history, you've heard of that. We had 90 Hercules there in case he shot a missile towards the United States.
When John F. Kennedy was ruling, right?
Right. Yeah. That was a little later when he passed away. I was in 65 to 68, and I was blessed. I was stationed there for 2 years. Went to school in El Paso, learned how to do the radar maintenance and all that for the Mikey Hercules, and then was stationed in Florida. So it's not like, actually I lived 10 miles from my house when I was stationed, so I had a good time.
It's not too far.
But a lot of guys don't have it so good.
Yeah. A lot of guys aren't even here, too.
Nope. Not here anymore.
Oh, when the sun beats down and burns the top of the roof, when your shoes get so hot, you wish you'd have thank you.
say to Sergeant, 6 o'clock in the morning, maybe a touch earlier, let's call in a fire mission, Sergeant. He says, why do you want to do that? I said, let's secure, man. We got the lagoon down there. I want to go swimming down there in that lagoon. So I said, all right, go ahead, make up a fire mission, call it in. So I make up this fire mission, tanks in the open, I give them the coordinates, I give them the azimuth from where we are. And the fire mission goes something like this. You say pocket kilo, that's the gun battery back, main side. This is pocket kilo 3, that was our forward observing post. Fire mission over. 3, this is pocket kilo, send your fire mission. Kilo, this is 3, tanks in the open, coordinates, the azimuth, and everything else. And normally once you give them that information, they come back and say, Roger, wait. So now they give that information to the FDC group. They plot all the information for the guns, cut the bags, the artillery, set everything up. Well, 5 minutes go by, and this is unusual. This is totally unusual to wait 5 minutes for a response from FDC. I think the fire mission is ready to go. I wait another 5 minutes, and I call back, Kilo, this is 3. Request update on fire mission. Roger, wait, 3. 15 minutes go by. This sucks. This is weird, man. Something's going on. Another 5 minutes go by and request another update. Well, we get the update, and it's pocket kilo 6, actual. That's the captain of the gun battery. And he calls us back and says, 3, this is 6 actual. Is this fire mission for real, or is this a practice fire mission?
Well, I say, these guys must have had a hell of a party, but we weren't there last night.
So, I think they're out celebrating. Sergeant calling me and asking me if this is real or not. 6 actual, this is 3. Request you say again, and he comes back and says, 6 actual. I say again, is this real or practice? Oh, now we look around at each other. We got the CBs in front of us, the Navy guys in front of us, and they're all got planks in their game, their rifles, and they're still playing it as a war game. I'm confused, the sergeant's confused. Tell the captain it's a practice fire mission, naturally. 6 actual, this is 3. It's a practice fire mission. 3, this is 6 actual. There will be no more practice fire missions from this point on. This point on, everything will be a real fire mission. Do you copy?
Hey, Sarge.
Hey, Sarge, this captain is telling us this is going to be real. Roger. I guess we're not secure. I think we're not going to the lagoon. Half hour later, we see F-4s coming right over. They were the Phantom jets. They would come right up to the fence line, take their afterburners in, which was maybe about 100, 150 feet over ahead. Kick those afterburners up, they go right up to the fence line and go straight up with the afterburners burning. And it was quite an experience to see these guys. They never flew over my position before. I'm like, wow, what's going on? Another 2 hours later, we see all the troop transport cargoes coming in, coming right into Pontano, one after the other. What's going on? 4 hours later, it happens to be on the other side of the bay where the S station was in Guantanamo. So now they had to come from the other side of the bay over to our side and up to the post and the fence line. And I look and go, here comes all these grunts, man, the Marine grunts. And you got flak jackets on, you got bandoliers of ammunition, grenades, machine guns. These guys don't have blanks. What kind of war game is this? We didn't have communications, we didn't have telephones. I mean, when you wrote to your mother in those days, your father, everything was handwritten notes, back and forth, and no telephones, no internet access or anything like that. So it was very interesting times. We learned a lot, and I always wondered, what would have happened if I told that captain it was a real fire mission? Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm gonna go a little with a little, a couple stories, and it's primarily thanks for Vietnam vets, not from me, although thank you, but from a Vietnamese gentleman. And briefly, I flew as a crew chief in Vietnam. First 6 months were Quy Nhon. Excuse me. Last 6 months were Phu Bai. We had two UH-1Ds, and we would support signal, flying into signal sites, up and down the coast, on K, down as far south as Natrang, Pleiku, and up north, Quezon, Nashaw Valley, etc. We carried mostly signal, enlisted people and generators and so forth to various signal mountain sites or mountain areas. In the combat time I have, flight time, aviation was a passion of mine. And we flew up and down the coast, and I would be in silent prayer sometimes going, God, why the war? Why Vietnam? I couldn't understand the pain, the anguish. The folks back home, the peace protest, the whole nine. I felt compelled to do it because the Vietnamese people were under a communistic rule. They were being killed. They were being bullied. Our men that enlisted, even got drafted, went over and did what John Flanagan was saying earlier. Gave their all, only to find out we come back and are called baby killers and are shunned and so forth. Well, the story I'm about to tell you is in essence the answer to my prayer some 43 years ago. I flew Monday to Sunday over churches, and coming out of those churches Monday to Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all the way down, were lines going out of those churches. So finally I couldn't stand it anymore, and I got a Vietnamese guy when we were on the ground, and I said, he got an interpreter, and I said, ask him about the faith. I said, I'm Christian and I don't have this kind of faith, because I know those people on the lines either had somebody killed, wounded, lost, or what have you, or they knew somebody, either they did or knew somebody. Well, the Vietnamese guy smiled at me and with compassion, with love, and said, thank you. That's a thank you to any Vietnam vet that's sitting here today. Whether you're a Remington Radio that had nothing to do with combat, or you flew choppers like my friend John Flanagan there. Didn't matter, infantry, whatever. You were in country for what? To support people that were being oppressed. And I feel very proud, and I feel proud for you fellas too. Welcome home, each and every one of you. And I wish you all success. But that's what the Vietnamese person said after thank you was, explain this to him very clearly, he said to the interpreter. In our country, God is first, family is second, and job is third. All right? What we flew for and fought for 40 some years ago is what kind of I look out into our society, and unfortunately a lot of it's secular, and our government, so forth, not to put a government down, but a lot of this stuff, I don't believe in socialism, I don't believe in communism. So when he said those three tiers, okay, it kind of brought a shock to me, and I gotta understand more. Well, that was the beginning of the Lord's answer, which I didn't know at that time. For years, I didn't put down I was a Vietnam vet. And then I realized, wait a minute, I have absolutely nothing to be ashamed of. Okay, the commitment, I stand proud, I stand with my brothers, and the key issue here is when employers realize that when you go into the military, all right, you could be Donald Trump, you could be a high state with multi-millions of dollars in the bank. Well, what does the military do? Well, they break you down and they build you back up again. Now, when they build you back up, there's an invisible code, and that code is, if you come in, I'm in combat, you come in, your name's Jim, my name's John. We introduce each other, but there's an unwritten law, and the code is, yo, Jim, not only I'm going to cover your back, Jim, I'll die for you. That's the commitment that the combat vet has. That's the military way. So when the Lord received my wife 7 years ago, I went into deep grief, as you can imagine. I went into the bottle. But during that process, I asked him a question, which I knew I'd get an answer, because I asked him a question 40-some years ago. And he did give me healing from Vietnam, which I'm still getting healed, and to go out and help others. At the same token, when he received my wife, it's like, what are you doing? Here comes the anger. Here comes this, here comes that. But I did ask him from my heart. You never failed me up until this point. I know you won't, but it sure doesn't feel like it. Well, as of course the time comes, when I was got back to work again, and that Vietnamese guy came in, I knew this was the beginning of something I had to share. And this is the beginning of it here. Right now I'm in transit, I'm going back into the VAs to claim Vietnam benefits. That I used to bitch at guys coming in saying, what's your percentage? And people around me said, no, you're entitled. Well, you know, it came to a point where I don't have hospitalization, but I'm looking at it in a different light. They said, come, get your benefits, get your benefits. Now I'm looking at, whoa, it's not about the benefits, although I'll take them. It's about going in, and maybe I can help somebody through the Holy Spirit. Iraq guys coming back over from overseas in their prime are committing suicide. The suicide now in the United States with the military is the highest it's ever been in any war. So that just goes to prove there's a lot of work to be done out there, and the key word is love. These freedoms are not free. Somebody has to buck up. Somebody has to step up to the plate. So the American, I still believe, like I say, America is a great country. I truly believe that we're going to swing this back around again, because there's too many unfortunate evil people in Washington now, Democrats and Republicans, all right? But bottom line is, I just wanted to thank everyone and have a great day. God bless.
California, and he was a diver, and he taught diver school in San Diego. He toured with the State Department in Thailand, and that's pretty much all I know about him. My grandfather, who is standing right there, Robert Felt. He was also in the CBs. He carried on his father's tradition. And I don't know much about what he did. He tried his best to do the same thing as his father. They both succeeded very well. And I'm proud of them for serving. And now I need to bring up my father, Peter Feld.
I did serve in peacetime. was a different era back in the 80s when you volunteered and things were looking good for college money and other benefits. Yeah, there was a Cold War, but it wasn't the same situation that many have faced before me or after me. It afforded me, though, some opportunities upon receiving Soldier of the Month while stationed in Germany. I was sent on a tour of the Battle of the Bulge. We went through every battlefield, we looked at every strategy, and as we did so, everything was very cold, very calculated. We talked about how the routes worked, what was the terrain. But then as we got to Patton's Grave, and if you've ever been out there to see the enormity of the cemetery that is there in Clairvaux, it is huge. We got off the bus very solemnly, and the cemetery itself is Patton's Grave, and then it radiates out in a semicircle of the troops that were that had died there. There are three sections to that semicircle. In 45 minutes of walking at a normal pace through the rows of graves, I got through about one-third of one-third. And that does not count the bodies of the dead that had been sent home. This is one battle. We very quietly got on the bus, and the tour guide, who had been a Belgian major and had been 16 years old during the battle, said, up until this point, everything has been like a chess game. But now that you've seen what can happen in reality, remember this. The only thing that separates you from them is time. I was fortunate in the way my time separated me from them. There are those now who serve who are less fortunate than I in how their time is separated from me. When we think about the commitment that people make, whether it's peacetime, whether it's wartime, the commitment's the same. The only thing that separates us is time.
I'm a CV veteran, as was my father, and I just wanted to tell you a little story about when I joined the CVs. I went through boot camp in San Diego, and from there I was sent to Subic Bay in the Philippines. And on my way to Subic Bay, my plane stopped at the island of Guam, and the next stop was at the island of Kwajalein, and we had about a five-hour layover in Kwajalein, and at the time, my father was a chief petty officer, and he was stationed in Kwajalein. And as a dutiful son and a dutiful father, he met the plane, and I hit him up for 20 bucks. So that I could have a good time when I got to Subic Bay. But mainly, I'm very proud of the service that my father gave to the country. He was 33 years in the Navy. He retired. He was retired 2 years, and he was unfortunately killed in a traffic accident. But he loved the Navy. I always wanted to be in the Navy. I thought that was going to be the life for me because I looked up to my father. But I really didn't care that much for it. I enjoyed the time I spent, but I figured this is not going to be my life. I did my enlistment, and then I went to work in civilian life and went to school, and finally became a teacher, and retired as a teacher in the state of New Jersey. We moved back here to New Jersey. And I just want to say thank you to all of the veterans. I know what you've been through. I've been there myself.
Drop of water in an endless sea. the ground, though we refuse to see. Dust in the wind, all we are is dust in the wind.
Vietnam veteran, combat. I guess you can tell what unit I was with, 101st Airborne, and in the first draft lottery on television, my number was 36. So, you know, what are you going to do? You know you're going. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. So a friend of mine called up, same number, and said, you want to join together? Buddy system. So we did. Problem was, the buddy lasted for 3 freezing days with no heat in Fort Dix. Then he went to the new barracks at Dix. I went to the old barracks at Dix. And then when we got out of there, I went to Fort Ord, California. He went to Fort Polk, Louisiana. When we get to Vietnam, he goes to the south and becomes in the first Cav. I go to the north and went to the 101st Airborne. I found out in 1997 there was something that we went on, was called Lamsong 719. And with research, I found out that that was the last big push that the Americans made into Laos. There was only one problem. We weren't in Laos. But we weren't in Vietnam either. So it was a tough deal. And I was there one night when we got off the choppers and set up and everything. The whole place was on fire. So we had to put everything out before we could even set up. So the first night, first and only time in my life, I played poker for money. And the next day, I get out and I'm in a river. I don't exactly know what happened. All I know is, the next thing I know, I see nothing but blood coming up out of the river. And I'm trying to get out, and I guess the guy seen it, because they jumped in and they got me out. And the gentleman before was talking about God and all that stuff. Well, I didn't see God, but I'll tell you what, with the loss of blood, I was... I was laying there, and all I remember is everything being slow motion. It was, I was at peace, but never seen God, never seen anybody else, and my medics put me together and medevaced me out, and after they sewed me up, because I wasn't that bad, they sent me to a replacement depot with the 5th Mechanized Infantry, and here I am, I'm struggling with my rucksack, my weapon, and this guy comes out and says, oh, let me help you. Okay. Well, he went to pick up the rucksack and couldn't. Took up 2 hands and he struggled like hell. So I come home and I got married 11 days before I went to Vietnam. My son was born while I was in Vietnam. And when I come home, I was a totally different person. And I was a good guy. I always thought I was a good guy, and it was different. I was aggressive. Somebody said they would hit the bottle. I also drank. Never did drugs. I thank for that. I never did drugs in Vietnam or any kind of else. I never even had sex in Vietnam, because those women just, where I was, they were shit burners. And you know, down south, they were, it was hookers, and they were dressed up, and they were nice and everything else. But where we were, it's terrible. Going back home, I ETS'd out of the Army. 2 days before Christmas, About 3 days after New Year's, I was back to work. I worked at Sears in Willowbrook, the auto center, and that was the only thing that was in Willowbrook at the time. The Sears store was built, but not open, and the rest of it wasn't even built. And when I got in there, and there was protesters, I knew there was protesters, but when I walked in, and they said, oh, a new guy, I said, no, so I got 4 years seniority. He said, how do you do that? I said, well, I've been in Vietnam. Well, that was a mistake. Because nobody wanted to know who I was. Nobody wanted to know nothing. My wife didn't want to know anything. The fact that one night, there was a light came through the second floor window. We lived on a second house in from a corner on the second floor. It was I had no clue. It was a headlight, a flashlight, don't know. All I know is, and when that flashed, I was up and running. Incoming, incoming, right? My wife's trying to hold on to me because she has no clue. The landlord's downstairs raising all kinds of hell because he didn't know what was going on. I didn't even know what was on until it settled down. And then it took quite a while for me to just even get back into bed. It's a tough thing, but that's what you do. You know, anybody that's had incoming, you know damn well what it's like, and you don't want to be where it was. So, I go back to work, nobody wants to know, I buried Vietnam. Completely. Everything. Never told anybody anything about it. All of a sudden, one of my lieutenants from Nam gave me a call at home, and said, hey, you want to join the National Guard? I said, what, are you crazy? I said, I don't even wear green. I don't have anything that's green. And so he said, well, come on up and have a drink. So I said, well, what the hell? We'll go up and talk. And he talked very well because I joined the National Guard. And I was in there for 10 years in an infantry battalion. I was a state instructor for 81 millimeter mortars. And I had a great time in Nam. 1997, I find out that I have PTSD. And I looked at the guy, it was an Army psychiatrist, because I was really having troubles and everything, because I couldn't figure out what was what. And the guy says, you got PTSD. I just looked at him. He said, you know what that is? I didn't know. And then he starts giving symptoms, which are, you know, in fact, he even asked me, he says, you got lights on your house? I said, oh, yeah, I got them all the way around. He says, you're protecting your perimeter. I said, what? You know, I mean, it's amazing. You do things because you don't know any better. It's subconscious. It's so subconscious that you have no clue what's going on. And, I'm better for what it was. I understand flashbacks. I can reason with dreamings. The dreams, they never go away. I don't care what anybody says. They do not go away. Flashbacks happened. I was in an island. I think it was Aruba. I wanted to go parasailing. So, oh, that's pretty neat. So I get in and start going up. All of a sudden, I'm on the coastline. Well, here I am. I don't know how high up in the air, but I had a flashback. All I seen was coastline. Couldn't tell you. If I wasn't strapped in, I probably would have fell out of it. Because I had no clue what was going on, where I was, or anything. Now, this is after the programs, and PTSD and that kind of stuff was scary. I'm sure everybody that was in Nam knows all about it, and there is a way to live with it. It's tough. You got to do it every day. I thank you very much for listening, and have a good day.
I thought it was fantastic. Very educational.
Did it affect you in any type of way?
I was sad to see so many people died in the Vietnam War, but it was also nice to see what they were fighting for and that people did survive, and it was for, you know, a good cause. It's educational.
Did it affect you in any certain way?
It made me sad. That's all I have to say.
Emotional? And it's emotional, and it's right there. I wish everybody could see it.
Did it affect you in any certain type of way?
Yeah. And my hat's off to the Vietnam vet.
Oh, yes. We're not seen as being welcomed, according to the picture in my memory. However, we welcome them and we love them. And
we had a nephew who was a Marine over there, and he came home.
Yeah.
I served in the American Legion with a lot of boys, not first airborne, and first cavalry, all good men.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Very well done. Very sad and yet not sad. But the thing that I keep thinking back to is how could they possibly, people, peace is fine, peace is what we all want, but people who used to spit on our veterans coming home who were fighting for our country, unbelievable, unbelievable. And I just thought,
I think about that a lot.
Yeah, I do.
I
remember it well.
Just what you went through, and then to come home and not be accepted.
I'm going to cry now.
Yeah.
It's moving.
You see, the thing is, like, the fellas coming home now, yeah, they're not really recognized because they're coming home in dribs and drabs.
Right.
See, World War II, when it was over. Those people come home and they were discharged and back to civilian.
Right.
I was in the Korean War. We come home, nobody even knew where it was gone. You know, guys say, where have you been? You know,
like you went on vacation or something, right?
Yeah. It was a nice day. Really did a nice
beautiful
job.
Day.
Yes,
yeah.
It was.
Thank you. Thank you very much.